Welcome. Thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Megan Boyle. I serve as the Executive Director for the Bayfield Heritage Association. This is our seventh John Matthew Black program of 2020 and our fifth virtual program. We have recorded our past programs if you want to check those out on our website, bayfieldheritage.org. And all of these educational programs are made possible thanks to a grant from the Apostle Islands Historic Preservation Conservancy. We are joined by John Klungness, who happens to be a BHA board member. He was born in Superior, Wisconsin to Norwegian immigrants. And in fact, he spent his freshman year of high school in Norway helping his grandfather doing traditional river logging. John graduated as a chemical engineer from the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 1961, and he has 8 years of industrial experience in the paper industry. He is a former research chemical engineer with the USDA Forest Service Forest Products Laboratory, and he's published over 80 papers, presented at technical conferences, and even has 2 patents. It's our pleasure to learn about the Civilian Conservation Corps and logging and reforestry in our area. So I will turn it over to John.
The title of my talk is The Civilian Conservation Corps Role in Reforesting Bayfield's Cutover. And my roadmap is 3 parts, and the background is 2 parts. The first part is to understand the problem, and the second part is to understand the solution. And then when I get talking about the CCCs, I'll also talk about their background, how they were organized, and what activities they did in the Bayfield region, and then some of the conclusions that we can draw from this presentation. To understand the problem, well, it was pretty easy. They wiped out the old growth, all the white pine and everything else in 50 years. It started about 1870 and finished up about 1920. And here you see a photograph of the cut over land. It was just terrible. So what are they going to do with it? That's kind of a problem. So you see, if you don't do anything, you see the big stumps there, it just goes to brush, and it's not good for farming. It's not good for logging. And I just love the quote by W.H. Auden, who said, "A culture is no better than its woods." I heard that a long time ago, but it's really stuck with me. Our woods were not in very good shape back then. So the cutover, the northern 22 counties, the northern tier was just cut over. Weyerhaeuser, when he cut over, he didn't have any more logs to cut to turn into wood, into lumber. And so he went out to the Pacific Northwest and he bought, I think it was 1 million acres at $6 an acre, big, big land purchase. And here you see in 1950 or 1960, the logs going from St. Helens in Oregon to Sawmill in Longview. And you see the logs there about, 50 years old or so. But they always did replant out there, which we never did. But the forest products industry, or the forest industry, it's like a meatpacking plant. If you have a pig or a hog, you want to optimize the ham. That's where the profit is. You can make sausages from scrap, and you can make paper from scrap. It takes a lot of effort. You have to have a pulp mill and a paper mill and a big crew of men. But with lumber, you can just cut it and dry it, and you've got something that's worth about the same price per ton. When you look at the forest, Weyerhaeuser looked at it as you've got to optimize the saw logs. And when Weyerhaeuser left, he still had a lot of land here. And he really invested heavily in Cloquet. He was heavily invested in the paper company in Cloquet, in wood conversion and diamond match. Cloquet is about 30 miles west of Duluth. It's a city of about 12,000 people. And there's like 1,800 jobs there. There used to be 1,200 in the paper mill, Northwest Paper Company, and then wood conversion, which made wood insulation, and diamond match, which made toothpicks and matches. So the people were very happy to have that and very loyal to the company. Northwest Paper Company, they did do some replanting. When you look at a sheet of paper, you want to have an even sheet of paper. You want to have very good formation. When the printer prints on it, when he's got a black background, he doesn't want a model black. He wants a solid black. And when you use aspen fibers are very tiny, very thin, very short. When you make paper with that, you get a very, very good sheet. You do need some reinforcing pine, longer fibers, and 10 or 15% of that. And jack pine, which was considered at one time just a weed tree, does that perfectly. So the Northwest Paper Company had a forestry department, and they had a head forester, and he had other foresters work with him, and they had a nursery, and they used to give the seedlings away. These are all pine seedlings. And they had to sign an agreement that they wouldn't sell these things for Christmas trees. Of course, they didn't enforce that, and people did make Christmas trees farms from them, but some of them forgot about it, and they turned out to be nice forests, of course. Northwest and all the other companies, all the other paper companies in this area in Wisconsin also had an effort, but it was sort of a small effort because aspen would reseed itself, cut it down, it would just grow back up again. That was perfect for them. The solution then was, should the cutover go into farming or should it go into forests? You're either on one side or the other. Like most arguments, it was both, forests and farming. In the early days of the 1900s, they had a lot of nice dairy farms up here, and they also did some replanting, of course. Wisconsin's first state forester is E.M. Griffith. He was appointed by Senator Bob La Follette, and he served from 1904 to 1915. And he was a man well-educated and just a dynamo. There's still old growth forests, and he wanted to save those and he wanted to replant. He had tremendous outreach. He lectured at the University of Wisconsin, promoted those conferences down there, spoke at civic groups, explains Europe's forestry practice, especially Germany, was heavy into this. Even Griffith's enemies, they would admit that he was a very honest person, a very ethical person, very smart person. Here you see a Curtis flying boat in 1915, and Griffith was behind that, and that was to spot forest fires. But they soon abandoned that. The plane was difficult to fly in the wind, and when they did spot a forest fire, it was, had a hard time communicating with the ground. It only lasted a short time, but it gave tremendous publicity to the effort to prevent forest fires. E.M. Griffith was totally shattered. The Supreme Court voted against him, and the legislation did too. Bob La Follette had established a forestry fund for Griffith for the forestry department in 1906, and he had a U.S. grant. He had 20,000 acres that he could locate any place in the state that was government land that would be good for forestry. And if somebody wanted to farm that, they would sell it to him for $3.50 an acre, and they would buy someplace else that was better suited for forestry. It was very forward-looking and accommodated both the farming and the foresters. But the Supreme Court ruled that they had done some procedure wrong and that it would have to be called invalid. So they wiped out that forestry fund, which was very important to Griffith because he was free of the legislature. He had this fund he could use and he didn't have to wait for funding each term. And then the legislature combined the state forestry department with two other agencies. There was a lot of people in the state that were opposed to the state buying forest land. They wanted it to be sold as farmland. They didn't think states should be selling land for $3.50 an acre. They could get a lot more for it, they thought. The farmers were really led by the Rhinelander News. That was a big center for it, and they got other newspapers to back them as well. Their backers were the railroad companies, the real estate agents, county politicians, land companies, and even the taxpayers. And they advertised around the turn of the century, if you come here and homestead, you can take that timber and sell it, and you'll have enough to pull the stumps and build a farm building. And look, this is a first planting. We have a big 60-acre oat field here, and the oats are over 6 feet tall. And they advertised that all over. And I know my grandfather over in Norway, his older sister, she wanted to get married to somebody who her parents didn't approve of. So in Norway, if you had 20 acres of tillable soil, you were well off. You could support a family very easily. My Aunt Maria and Ole went to Rhinelander. They eloped. They got married in 1906. They homesteaded, and they had a farm. In 1920, they were living in Rhinelander. My aunt was a school teacher, and Ole was working in the paper mill. So they had a good life, I think, but better than what they had at farming. I know probably the farm wasn't very suited for agriculture. And so they're talking about the cutover. One writer says the 18 counties in the region, they were the least developed in 1900. They grew the fastest between 1900 and 1940, but then they began to lose farmland at a higher rate than the state. This portion of the state, northern Minnesota and the UP, they all have the same history. But here you see where the sand barrens are. It goes from Bayfield County, goes part of Douglas County, Washburn County, Burnett County. All that land in there is really sand. It goes down 600 feet, nothing but sand. There's no hard pan, anything, just sand. Pine trees grow on there just beautifully, but it's not a good place for a farm. So now I'm going to go into the background of the CCCs. I'm going to talk about the history. FDR was the real author, the founder of the CCCs. He was born in 1882 and he died in 1945, 62 years old. He's fairly young. He was born in Hyde Park. That was really Springwood out east, upstate New York. It was 640 acres. His father, he had bought that in 1866 for $40,000. It was a lot then. And they worked a lot at first on making the mansion that they had. They kept adding to it and make it more beautiful, et cetera, et cetera. And Franklin was very involved in that. He worked with his mother. His father had died early. But then about 1911, they turned their attention to the grounds. They changed the whole appearance of Hyde Park. They planted 400,000 acres on marginal farmland. And then they upgraded the farmland that they did have. They started farming it properly. When Franklin became governor of New York, 1929, for 3 years, he started a forestry program, reforesting marginal land. And it was quite successful. And here's a picture of Springwood at Hyde Park. This is what him and his mother worked on. But it was just a palatial place. They had foreign royalty come, all dignitaries, all the big important people in the United States. It was quite a place. So within the first 3 weeks, FDR formed the CCCs. It didn't take them long. The mission statement was pretty brief. All rural lands, federal, state, local. The CC organization was to work on forestry, prevention of soil erosion, and flood control. That was the original mission. The mission expanded and expanded and expanded. The mission was huge by the time it ended. But at that time, there was teenage hobos. There was they estimated 250,000 teenage boys roaming the United States. They were always filthy, always hungry. No jobs to be had. Sometimes I guess people would feed them, but never any money. Nobody had any money. They were potential criminals, really. I remember reading in one of my reference books, this boy, this Jim Mitchell from Kenosha. His father came home and he cried and he had lost his job. And they had to go to their grandmother to eat. She fed him. They didn't have any food. He ran away from home in 1933. He was 17 years old. He ran away with a buddy. When they were working in a circus, he met an army officer who said, well, you know, you should join the CCCs. It'd be quite an experience for you. There was quite a diversity of boys, like joining the army. So he did. The requirements were that you be unmarried, male, U.S. citizen, between 17 and 28, 6 months enlistment. You could extend to a maximum of 2 years. You'd work 40 hours a week. You got $30 a month, dollar a day. You had to send home 25. And you keep five, but you multiply that by 20. So he was making $600 a month and he'd keep 100 for himself. And they furnished housing, food, clothing, medical care, transportation, and the family had to be on relief. The young fellows, instead of being a burden to the family, they were like the breadwinners. Initial call was for 250,000 enrollees and it cost the CCs about $1,000 a year. So they had a budget. Eventually they included 14,000 Indians, they had stayed on the reservation, and 200,000 blacks, and a few camps for women. Everybody wanted to join the CCCs. They had a very good reputation. A typical enrollee would be from 18 to 19 years old, had 8 years of school, been 7 years unemployed, weighed 147 pounds. Typically, they'd gained 12 pounds. So when they came in, they were 135 pounds. But 147, 5 feet 8 1/4 inches, just about my dimensions. And they've been in for about 9 to 12 months in the CCCs. And this is an excerpt from FDR's speeches in 1933. And people were moving from the farms into the cities. And he was afraid that they had lost their work ethic. And so he says, you know, to appreciate that satisfying reward and safe reward come only through honest work. And time and again, I'd read the testaments to the boys that say, I went in feeling like a boy, but I came out feeling like a man. I had learned how to work a skill. I could be a mason. I could be a woodcutter. I could do all these things. And here you see the guys being examined before they go in. They also had local experienced men, and these were needed to instruct the CCC men. A lot of these guys came from Milwaukee or Chicago. They didn't know anything about the woods. And these LEMs were usually employed loggers. Usually older guys married and lived nearby. They'd go home at night and they needed to be on relief. They were happy to get the work and they were very much needed. They were like foremen. They would teach the kids how to use the equipment. They had four departments, the Department of Labor, which would recruit, the Department of War, which would train them and the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Interior, which had programs that needed to be done. It was just a miracle of cooperation. The first recruit was in April 1933. It was by far the most popular of all the New Deal programs, whether you're Republican, Democrat, everybody, it's like 80 or 90% approval rating. And eventually, they had four agencies in the beginning, but eventually there was 25 agencies. All the agencies wanted to be part of it. And here you see in 1938, each dot there represents one camp. And by 1942, there was more than 4,000 CCC camps. And you can see in Wisconsin, especially the upper part, we had plenty of camps there. And here's a map of Wisconsin. You can see up in Bayfield, we had seven camps. We had more than our share. Up towards Rhinelander, we had another bunch there. The first CC camp in Wisconsin was Camp Brinks, just 10 miles west of Washburn. So we really needed it up here, and everybody knew it. And so we got first picks. They had Camp Brinks in Washburn, they had Camp Cable, Camp Delta, Camp Drummond, Camp Pigeon Lake in Drummond, Camp Horseshoe in Moqua, Camp Taylor in Grandview. They had a lot of projects. Planting trees was the biggest one. 90% of all the work was done by hand. In 9 years, they planted over 1 billion trees in Wisconsin. The biggest project they had was planting trees over the 20 counties in the Northwest Cutover. Shawquamigan Forest was in very, very poor condition. The Springs Camp. It was formed at Fort Sheridan, Illinois. It was 640 the company. They averaged 190 men, mainly from Milwaukee. And here you see them. They got their army overcoats. They got their army boots on, duffel bags, ready to be tree soldiers. And here you see them in their fatigues or being inspected by an army officer a couple weeks down there at Camp Sheridan. Here they're marching, getting some physical training. They left Illinois April 26, 1933. 8 days later, they arrived May 4th. And here you see them crossing the Sioux River Bridge. And the Brinks Farm, these were sort of like daredevil people that came out and homesteaded in this area. Lillian Elizabeth Ann Mason. She was an upper-class English woman. You can kind of tell it. She's got two middle names. She was born in 1864 in Southwest Wales. That's a coal mining region of England. Her grandmother was a first cousin to Queen Victoria. Queen Victoria had a lot of kids, so a lot of people were related to Queen Victoria. She moved to Southwest Wisconsin near Mineral Point with her family to a lead mine area. It was quite a prosperous area at that time. She married and then divorced in 1893, and she had two sons. She joined up with the Buffalo Bills Wild West Show as a sharpshooter and a trick rider. And she said it was the most happiest part of her life. She said the circus people just took care of each other. They looked out for each other. And they just had a very, very adventurous, exciting life. And finally, when she got too old for that, she married Orra Brinks. And they homesteaded a half a section west of Washburn. And it was such poor land. So they finally sold off their acres. They had quite a few acres. And they probably sold it for $3.50 an acre. So they had something to go on. But here, if you go out that road, you'll see a sight of it. So Camp Brinks, it originally had six 40-man tents. In the wintertime, they moved to near Mellon because they didn't have good enough shelter. They returned in the spring, and the farm buildings were converted to a kitchen and a mess hall. They had 8-man tents with wooden floors. You can see the forests were just wiped out. All they had was brush, just brush. And a big, big job to reforest that. One technique I read about, they had like 180 men standing in a row. Each man grabbed a grub hole and they walked 6 feet apart, 2 paces forward on command. They removed the sod in a 4-by-foot area and then go 2 paces forward again on command. And then the next day they'd come back and they'd plant the seedlings, about 500 trees per man per day. These were little small 6-inch seedlings, make a hole with a steel bar, place a seedling in, tamp it down, move to the next patch on command. If they had tractors, they would dig furrows. They would plant the furrows. It made it a little bit easier for them, but mostly done by hand. And the mess hall, that was a very popular place. Originally, it was staffed by enlisted men, but eventually the CCs would do their cooking. And here you see the Thanksgiving menu. They had English celery, olives, roast turkey, sage dressing, cobbler gravy, Virginia baked beans, mashed potatoes, sweet potatoes, cream peas, shrimp salad, Parker House rolls, mincemeat pie, pumpkin pie, French pastry. And at the end, they had cigarettes and cigars. Oh, man, these kids were living a good life. because of all the slash they left behind from the cutover. In 1936, they had several fires around the camp. They started around Iron River and they spread to the forest near Mauquoa. These kids didn't think anything of it. They were so common, they were just considered part of a day's work. Here you see them fighting the forest fires by hand, not much equipment. And camp brinks move several times. So usually for warmer quarters in the winter, they go into Camp Morris, Camp Drummond, down by Grandview, near Cable. But the brinks, I think, could hold about 25. And so they just have detachments going there for brushing and planting and burning the brush. Alan Spoonman is from Ashland. And one of his entries in 1935, he said he volunteered on a 25-man team to go up to the brinks camp. He said, it looks different. He said, the place looks bare without the tents. It's been brushed out all over. The old mess hall looks different than the last time I saw it. Something nice about eating and sleeping in the same building, though. I suppose they had a mess hall and a bunkhouse in one building and probably a machine shed in the other. He said, tomorrow we burn brush. And if you go out to there, you can get there very easily. It's on a very nice road, blacktop road. And you could see the foundation of the building still there. And look at the size of the trees. This is a Bayfield County forest near Camp Brinks. This has been thinned out many, many times since the 30s. It's beautiful, a lot better than the brush was there. And here you see another photo of the Bayfield County forest. And here the Shawamigan National Forest, Shawamigan Nicolet now, National Forest on the other side. You can see they do replant. And so I don't know how you feel about clear cutting, but they do replant. And that's really the secret to replant. And they do have some techniques in planting in the understory, which is what I try to do on my little lot. But, you know, I think that's a lot easier. If you want to go there, there's like two ways. You go to Washburn, take Highway C. It's easy to miss. You take Forest Road 236. Or if you're coming from Superior, say, you can stop at Ino. There's only one road that goes on that goes right up there. And you'll see very, very beautiful forestry. You don't see it from the highways, but if you get in there, you can see that they're doing a really good job. And here is the CCC garage at Valhalla Ski Area. The CCC developed that too. They had a ski jump there, and ski runs, and supposedly some buildings from Brinks Camp were moved to Valhalla. And then over here, just the south side of Washburn, that red part of the building there, that came from Valhalla. So it could have come from Brinks to Valhalla to there. And if you go a little about 3 miles further south, you'll see affordable auto repair. There's a steel building on the right there. But this building here, if you talk to the owner and you talk to the people in Washburn, some of the older people, they say, well, that came from Camp Brinks. That was one of the buildings there. In those days, they didn't tear a building down. But when they left, they left those buildings and people would move them all the way from Camp Brinks, like 13 miles away. They moved it, long ways to move. You wouldn't think they would bother. The Wisconsin CC program included 75,000 men from Wisconsin, about 15,000 men from outside of Wisconsin. It's $96 million financial obligation. They planted 265 million trees in Wisconsin, 39,000 acres in the Shawamigan Nicolet National Forest, which has a value today just of red pine of $156 million. And that doesn't count a lot of other things that they've done. This is just what's still standing after thinnings and thinnings. But it really set the example for government reforestation. The national forests have copied them, the county forests, the state forests. You know, they set an example for them and they've carried on with it. And it's been very successful. Government forests are very well managed. And now they say that the big problem is more funding. For example, the Forest Service gets $5 billion a year funding. The military gets like $700 billion. But the Forest Service, the $5 billion, they've got to spend half of that on fighting forest fire. They don't have anything left for really managing land. But the private has not been so successful. There's an awful lot of private land, and that's owned along the highways mainly. And so when you drive through Wisconsin, you see a lot of brushland. Some landowners are excellent stewards, most don't. The managed forest law is insufficient for good forestry. If you put your land in the managed forest law, you get a tax break. The forester will come out and say, you should do this and you should do that. And he'll say, I can't afford it. That's just way beyond my means. He'll say, well, just don't do any damage and manage it the best you can. But here you see on the west side of the golf course, Bob Nelson's plantation. It's just beautiful. It was planted in the 50s. It's 20 acres. He's thinned it out several times. And it's a really good example of what can be done. Bob's plantation, first of all, it was a cutover. And then it was a bean field for the Bayfield cannery in 1930s. Tony Larson owned it. And then that 20 acres was planted by Dalton and Bill Hauser. The two-thirds north, closest to the road, was planted in 1953. And the south part, further in, was planted in 1965. And then Randy Erickson has an adjacent plantation, just about as big and just about as nice. So those are really beautiful. I wanted an example of brush. I didn't have to look very far. I just turned the camera 180 degrees, and there you see a nearby plot. I'm so enthused by something I read on the Wall Street Journal just recently. California just stated the Cap and Trade Act, manufacturers that emit CO2. First, they give them a cap free. They say you can emit up to so much. And then they can say, well, you have to pay for that cap. And if you're going above that, you got to pay a lot. But they can buy the rights from foresters, private foresters, say, for example, and they buy how much carbon that you got sequestered in your trees, and they get a check every year from the people that are polluting. It's not without controversy, but I think for up here, it would be a very good incentive for private forest land owners. They get a check every year according to how much carbon they've sequestered, and then begin to see, well, we got to encourage bigger and bigger trees, you know, so that's an economic incentive. These are my references, and this ends my talk.
Well, thank you, John. Once again, thank you for joining us. And if you enjoy, we appreciate your support too. You can donate securely through our website on our support page. And this concludes our program.